Page 14, we discuss the Kohen Gadol need to be out of his home for 7 days period prior to the Yom Kippurim, and the reason he needs to lehitragel la'avodah, to get used to the service in Beit HaMikdash. Since the essence of the work on Yom Kippur made by the Kohen Gadol, they sages wanted him to practice, in our simple language is rehearsal, right?
Mm-hmm.
To do rehearsal for his work. So they ask him to do certain works that it's not part of his requirement in a daily basis. The goal is obviously to get used to the to those works, and then the Yom Kippurim he will do that properly. Now we are zooming in that walk. So Mishnah, page 14. Kol shivata yamim. Hu zorek et adam. So all the 7 days that the Kohen Gadol isolated, he is coming out and staying in Mishkat Paridrin. So he need to sprinkle the blood of the two daily offering. And Rashi tells us here, כדי שיהיה רגיל ומזומן בעבודת יום הכיפורים. Again, as we said, in order for him to get used with the work of the Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. And then הוא מקטיר את הקטורת. So he, on a daily basis, they used to use the golden altar and bringing every day some amount of essence. Incense, one in the morning and one in the afternoon. So they have a different odor, a different smell, and that's what he does at that time. By the way, they said to us that reading the Ketoret, we have it right every morning before Shacharit and Nusach Sfarad, you know Gil, that they do it also before Mincha, is a Sgula Le'ashirut, that it's like, it's a sign for wealth. If one saying it, but anyway, metiv et hanerot, and he prepared the candles. So in other words, he prepared the lamp of the candle burn in order to light them, because every day, all these 7 days, the Kohen Gadol used to do this all these. Ptilot, the small wicks that extinguish, so he set it up properly. The Rambam said that the lighting candles meaning hatava preparation, but anyway, הוא מקריב את הראש ואת הרגל, and he sacrificed the head and the hind leg of the daily offering. So those part of the offering, it was made in the outside altar, and the high priest was standing at the entrance of that altar and bring the limb of the daily offering. Ubishar kol hayamim im ratza leakriv makriv, and the rest of the day, all the other days of the year, if the high priest wishes to sacrifice any of the offering, he sacrificed them. And shekohen gadol makriv chelek barosh venotel chelek barosh, because the kohen gadol, the high priest, sacrifices any portion that he chooses first, and he takes any portion that he chooses first. So as she said here, mana yafa shivchar lo, which means he has the privilege to choose which part he wants to use. So the Gemara said, Man Tana, who is the Tana who taught this Mishnah? Amar Rav Chisda, de lo ke Rabbi Akiva. Rav Chisda said that this Mishnah is not according with the opinion of Rabbi Akiva. As it, if they were according to the opinion of Rabbi Akiva, Dik Rabbi Akiva, Amar Taho Shanafla Alav Azaa, Tim Ato. So, when it's come to sprinkle the Mei Chatat, we said it several times, it's important to repeat that he go in a reverse order, which means the Kohen who prepare and sprinkle the water, he become impure, and the person who received it become pure. So in other words, the Kohen himself need to be purified after he sprinkle the water of the sin offering on the person who wasn't pure. So they said, Rabbi Akiva tells us that if a pure person, that he received the water of the sin offering, so that's make him impure. Why? Because what do we do with the Kohen Gadol? In the days that he is put in a preparation, they said that they sprinkle on him the water of the sin offering. So if that's the case, heichei avid avodah, how can he do this work in those days? According to Rabbi Akiva, he is impure. The Tanya, v'izata or alatame, and the pure person will sprinkle it upon the impure person. So what we emphasize is that he sprinkles the water upon the impure person comes to teach us that if he sprinkle on al tahor, alatame tahor, ve'alatahor tame, divrei Rabbi Akiva. So what Rabbi Akiva tells us, that he go in the reverse order. That one was a ritually impure person, he become pure, and if he sprinkle on a pure person, that person become ritually impure. So what we see here, the word alatameh, there are some who take it out, because it's obvious that you have to sprinkle on an impure person. But anyway, you see here, according to Rabbi Akiva, it goes in a reverse order, that the person who is impure become pure, and one who is pure become impure. V'chachamim omrim, the sages come out from the word hatame. So they derive a different halacha. Ein hadvarim alalu amurim, ela bedvarim hamekablim tuma. So he said, all of this teach us only if it perform on item susceptible to impurity, which means the water that was sprinkled on items not susceptible to impurity, it's not considered a sprinkling. So in general, we have a rule that if any type of work makes in the Parah Adumah or with the Mei Chatat, with the water of the sin offering, so they are becoming invalid from using it in order to purify the those who are impure. So for example, if he takes this part of the Ezov, he take this the hyssop, and he document with the water of the sin offering, and he sprinkle in a way that it's not considering the proper sprinkling. So it's considering that he does some work with that water, and that water become invalid. So we said he my he, what we derive from this explanation, kidetnan. We learn in the Mishnah in Tractate Parah chapter 12. Nitkaven lehazot ala beema vehiza ala adam. Here we talk about the intent. A person intended to sprinkle the purification water on animal. So the animal, it's important to know that they not become impure while they're alive. The all halachot of animals apply only after they're dead. So he said here, if he intend to sprinkle on a person and he sprinkle upon the animal, and the opposite, if he intend to sprinkle on animal and he sprinkle on a person, so he said, im yesh ba ezov yishne. So if the water remain on the hyssop that he used to sprinkle the water, he should repeat the action and sprinkle the purification water on a person to purify him. Why? Because we said that since the first sprinkle was unto a person who can become impure, so the water remaining on the hyssop may be reused, and it's not disqualified by improper use. So So again, imagine that you have this hyssop and it's used in different purpose. I have a long explanation in my book, Birak Klomar Berashi, because there is a Klomar here. Rashi said, ראויין השיריים לעזות על אדם שצריך חזאה, דהיכה דלא נתכוון לו וחזר ושינה, צריך לא יכול להדביר. So, obviously, here if you go by the Rashi, there are two different גרסאות, two different ways. Rashi here and the Rosh, in the Pirush המשניות in Parah and the Ravid, explain that if he intend to sprinkle on the animal and he sprinkle on a person, so he said, that what does that mean, yeshane? He can use the water there on the person that needs it. So, meaning, even the first person that he sprinkled on him, he become ritually pure. So, Yeshane, it's almost like a commandment that he should do it again. That's one avenue. But you see, in the Ravid, and also in the Rambam in Chot Parah Adumah, that he doesn't need to do it again. In the Pirush Mishnayot, he explained, since the water, the leftover water, is no longer valid to sprinkle, lo yishaneh, meaning he doesn't need to do it again. So it's a very, very, very long explanation I have here in my book. What exactly Rashi meant here when we use the word klomar. The way I come out is that yeshane, it's not an obligation, but it's proper to do it. It's proper to sprinkle again, but you're welcome to read it in the book. It's a long, long, long mahalach. But anyway, what we see here, there's two girsaot. Nitkaven la'azot al adam v'izal ha'bimayim, yesh ba'ezov lo yeshane. So, the first girsa is if he does melacha in the water of the Azov, so they become ritually impure. But the capability of making a person as a recipient of ritual impurity apply only to the person, but not on the behemah, because behemah, the animal, is not considering sprinkling, so it's considering only melacha that does some work. So he doesn't need the new water. But if he sprinkled on a person and the water left, so he can continue again. So because we judge here in general on the action, not the intent. You see, in several sugiyot, for example, pigul, etc., you have to figure out what is the person's intent. You saw it also in Ilchot Shabbat. But here you do not go by the intent, you go by the action, the physical action of a person. The second gear side is Tosfot Yeshanim, and they bring it in the Rach. Anyway, Ma'itama de Rabbi Akiva, what's the reason? What's the basis? What's the reason for the opinion of Rabbi Akiva? So because he said that sprinkle the water of Chatat on a pure person, make him impure. Nichtov Rachmana, the Gemara elaborated and said, Rachmana, by the way, is the name of God, is the name of Torah, that's compassion. Says Nichtov Rachmana v'izah ha-tahor alav, let the pure person will sprinkle upon him, and it will be clear that it is a is upon the aforementioned impure person. So they said Maya latame. What does that mean? The word on the impure, Shma mina alatame tahor alatahor tame. If he sprinkle on the impure person, that person become pure by being recipient of the water. But if he does that on the pure person, he become impure. Verabanan, how the sages explain it? So they said, Hai, lidvarim amekablim tum'ah, hu de'ata. Over there, they apply to a certain item that received ritual impurity. Avalacha. So here, in the situation of Rabbi Akiva, that a pure person receive this meichatat, the water of sin offering, kal vachomeru, that the person remain pure. Im alatameh alatahor lo kol shekin, if you sprinkle the meichatat on a person that is ritually impure, he become tahor, So if a person is already pure, for how much so that he remain pure? For Rabbi Akiva, how Rabbi Akiva explained it, and he said, "Haynu de ke'amar Shlomo." That's what we said in the book of Ecclesiastic, chapter 7. Amarti ech kema vehi rechoka mimeni. So King Solomon said, "I said I will become wise, but it eludes me," which means even Solomon was a very wise person, could not understand the contradictory nature of the sprinkling of the purification water that purified an impure person and impurified a pure person. So who are we to understand if King Solomon did not understand it? But but we go by the Gzerat HaKatuv. The Rambam tells us, the Rambam contradicted himself, but the Rambam tells us in general that there is a concept that we have to accept the mitzvot as is, because there are mitzvot, honor your father and your mother, for example. So we all understand that it's a value to honor parents, you know, they brought it to the world. When you see mitzvah like red heifer, you see a mitzvot sending the bird from its nest, no kind of mitzvot that it's very hard to comprehend. So Rambam in one place said that you have to take it as a Lord commandment. You don't ask questions, you don't try to understand. The Rambam himself, in the Guide for the Perplexed, in the later book, tried to go at length to bring the explanation of the mitzvot. And that book have a lot of issues in the Jewish history. Yeah. There are those who forbids people to read it. It was a lot. The Rambam himself said that you should read
the mitzvah of the Paradama.
Mitzvah of Paradama, for example, try to explain it to public.
Well, I mean, one of the questions I have now is, I understand. So a person, you know, if someone's tamei, they get sprinkled by the ashes, they become tahor. Well, the other solution is they could toivel, right? They could.
Yeah, but how about
why himself? Well, I understand. No, I know it goes the other way. My point is, why would they require the ashes of the Paraduma to become tahor when they could toivel?
Because the toivel in that sense, it's not sufficient.
Is it a different sort of impurity?
Very different.
Okay, I mean.
So the whole process of sprinkling, the way we understand this para, is the idea that the whole domain of the impurity is different.
So how do these, I mean, an example of how these people that would require sprinkling by the ashes, how would they have become, an example of how they could have become tamei?
So they explain here that there are certain list of causes.
Oh, okay, so then.
But the key is that.
So we're not just talking a regular zava, zava, or nida, or anything like that. We're talking about other causes.
Mainly the practical way, they use it in a very few times, but when they use it, it was those special cases. The point is, it's much deeper. The point is that the question that King Solomon have a problem is, how come the Kohen who's doing all this...
Well, no, and I understand becomes...
Yeah.
Yeah, so I get, well, we get that that's different. So.
Yes, so they said here, Verabanan, what's the problem King Solomon have according to their view? So I said, you said, Ahu lamaze velamazin alav tahor, vanogea bahen tameh. So according to the sages, one who sprinkled the water and one who upon the who sprinkles the water pure, but one who touches the water unrelated to sprinkling is impure. So it's, you don't understand how exactly it works and why it works. So they said umaze tahor. So you're going to tell me that one who sprinkled the water actually is pure? Ve'aktiv, the Torah said in the book of Bamidbar, chapter 19. Umazem mei hanida yechabez gadav. The Torah said that he who sprinkles the purification water will wash his clothes. So, in other words, he needs to take his water and toivel them in a mikveh. So it means the one who sprinkled the water of chataat became impure by sprinkling it. My maze, what does that mean when you use the word maze? Said here, nogia, the one who touched. So he said, v'aktiv maze, v'aktiv nogia. But it's written, one who sprinkled, and it means, what is that, he sprinkled? Sprinkle nogia, that it's written both of them. So how you tell me that maze meaning nogia? Ve'od maze ba'e kibuz b'gadim. Nogia lo ba'e kibuz b'gadim. The one who sprinkles requires washing his clothes. So it means that it's a more severe level of impurity. And one who touches does not require washing of his clothes. So you see here that he who sprinkles is not referring to one who touches. So ela mai maze no se. So this the meaning of he who sprinkles is applied to one who carries the purification water. So they said v'nichtov rachmana no se mai ta'ama aktiv maze. So the Torah should say the one who carries. Why it's written that he was sprinkled is written that referring to caring. Hakamash belan deba'inan shi'ur haza'a. That teach us that in order to become impure from carrying purification water, one must carry the measure required for sprinkling. So it means that one who carry that water in the level that it can sprinkle on someone who's ritually impure, he become impure, and someone who carry less than that is not become impure. So they say the Gemara challenged that and said, "Hanicha leman damar hazaa tzricha shiur. El leman damar hazaa en tzricha shiur ma'ika lemeima." We understand this according to one who said that sprinkle on the corb, one who touches a corb, needs to be in a certain measure and not less than that. But one who said that he doesn't need to have a clear measure, what we learn from that? So again, the question that we asked originally, if the Torah meant to say nose, and they use word mazeh, one who sprinkle, why? Why you don't say clearly no sin? That's it. So he said, afilu leman da'amar haza'a en tzricha shiur. Even you go by the one who said that sprinkle does not require a minimum measure of water. So what's that apply? Hanemilei agaba de gavra. That's apply the back of impure men. Any amount will suffice. Aval bemana. However, in the vessel into which one dips the azov, the hyssop, in order to sprinkle the water, so you have to have tzricha shihu. They have a certain measure of water required. Ditnan, we learned in Mishnah, in Tractate Para, chapter 12. Kama ye bahen v'yehe kedei haza'a. How much we need in the vessel that it would be equivalent to the measure required for sprinkling. So the Mishnah wants to clarify the amount of water needed in order to purify the one who carries the water of impure water. So they said the amount needed is kedesh itbol. It must be equivalent to the measure required to dip. Aletamud bet rashei give olin. The top of the stem of the hyssop branch into the water and sprinkle it. Let me just give some explanation to that. Usually the azov, I rather use the word azov instead of hyssop so we all communicate properly.
Zatar.
What?
Zatar.
I don't know if it's the proper zatar.
Hyssop, yeah.
Gilbert, is zatar? This is like the green one that we put.
Yeah, that you, if you look at the yeah, look that's fine. Hyssop. I mean, it's not the branch, but it's a, yeah, the herb that from it. Yep. Yeah.
So usually, when you put that azov, it absorbs certain amount of water. Mm. So when it's come to measurement of meichatat, the water of the sin offering, in order to make a person impure, it's the amount that the tap of those ezov, you call it nana or ezata, whatever, the tap of that ezov reach the water. That's sufficient. Now here the we said kedesh yitbol, the top of the stem. So even according to one who said that there is no minimum measure of water in the vessel, that there is a minimum measure of for sprinkling. So Rashi here said klomar kedesh yitbilem bahem tvila shiye ba kedel leatiz mimena. So the Gemara in Masechet Nida, page 13b, we see here that Rashi said, "Kama yu b'mayim ve'ebem kedei azah, kedei sheitbol rashi givulim b'yaze." Klomar she'ebem kedei azov levan ma she'ezov bolea. So it means, I just give you the short because I have here in my book a long explanation. I try to abbreviate that the measurement, it's just to have a little bit touching the water of the ezov touching the water. The ezov is observing water that immediately. So in other words, if you put even the top of the ezov in the water and it's a very little there and you sprinkle, it's already in effect. So that's, I think, what Rashi meant here. Anyway, up to this point, the Gemara tells us that the Mishnah we learn not according to Rabbi Akiva, that said that the pure person that receive a water of sprinkled water, he become impure, because according to that view, since we sprinkled on the high priest all the 7 days of his staying in Lishkat Paridrin, he cannot walk in the Beit HaMikdash in those days. Abaye Amar, Afilu Teima Rabbi Akiva, Abaye said, even if you say that the Mishnah is according with the opinion of Rabbi Akiva, who said that the purification of water impurifies the pure, the difficulty can be resolved. David Avodah Kule Yoma, that he does his work the entire day. Ulefanya Madwale, only getting close to the end of that day, so then you sprinkle the water Maichatat, Vetavil Ve'avid Arev Shemesh. So he right away is toivel in the mikveh, he dug himself in the ritual bath, and in the evening he became pure, or in other words, from the sunset. So what we see here, his level of impurification only at the end of the day, after he completed all this work, and in the evening he returned to his level of ritual impurity in order for him to walk on the following day. So if you go that, so according to Rabbi Chisda, as I said, the Mishnah not going by Rabbi Akiva, so it means that it's hard to put it together with the way Abaye said, that the Chazon Ish said in Orach Chaim Kuf Chav, Orach Chaim 126, that he elaborates why exactly he needs to go to that process. But the Gemara continued and said, all the 7 days, umaktir et ha'ktoret umeitiv et ha'neirot. So the Gemara said that the Mishnah said that each of the 7 days, the Kohen Gadol burns the incense and removes the ashes from the lamps. So we said, Alma, why you need to do in that process? Ktoret bereisha ve'adar neirot. You have to go the other way around. Incense is burned first, and then the lamp is clean. So you see here the contradiction. Beraminu, we learn in Tractate Amid chapter 3, Mi shezacha bedishun mizeh be'achapnimi, u'mi shezacha be'menorah, u'mi shezacha be'ktoret. It was a lottery, and it was a process. So it was the first one that won, meaning that he had the privilege to remove the ashes from the inner altar. And then the other one, the next one that won, has the privilege to do what? The candle burn. And only then it's deal with one with the privilege to select the incense. So what you see here, that there's a process. What do you do here? First, removing the ashes from the candle burn. And then you go and you burn the incense. So that's contradicted to what we said here. Omar Ravuna commented, responded, and he said, Man Tana Tamid. Who is the one who taught the Mishnayot in the Tractate Tamid? Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpahu. So that was the one, Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpah is the one who taught this Mishnayot. So he said, so the Seder Avoda, the way that they did the work, was different between the Tractate Tamid and here. So it means that over there the Mishnayot learned by Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpah. And this Mishnayot we learned by the sages that disagree with him in this matter. So the Gemara said, Va'ipcha Shamin Alei. We learn this in the name of Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpah, that he disagrees with the regular Mishnah, Masechet Tamid. So if that's the case, you can't say that Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpah is the Tana that learned this Mishnayot in the Tractate Tamid. Ditna. Now we zoom in the Mishnayot in Tamid. Tamid chapter 4, the first Mishnah. Balo lekeren mizrachit tzfonit. The Kohen that sprinkled the blood of the daily offering. So he entered. This Mishnah explained the process of sprinkling the daily offering, the daily blood on the altar. So it's different from each korban. Each offering was different. They didn't do it the same. So, for example, the burn offering, they do it in the four corner of the altar. It's like two matanot. You give it and then you sprinkle the blood. It's all four. So it's two and two. the daily, it's also the burn offering, so it needs to have, which we read every morning, and shtei matanot shen arba, two that they are four. So they said, balo lekeren, if the Kohen, when the Kohen come, who sprinkled the blood of the daily offering, he goes to the corner of east, north of the altar, noten mizracha, Tzafona, he put the blood, so the blood will continue, mitpashet, is going further from east to north, and then he go around the altar until he reach ma'aravit dromit, the west-south, noten ma'arava daroma, he sprinkle on that corner of the altar, that it's continue west-south, and we learn in regard to this Mishnah, Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpah Meshane. Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpah, he goes different. How? He says, Betamid in the burn offering of a daily offering. So he said, Mizrachit Tzfonit. When a Kohen come in the east, north of the altar, Noten, he sprinkled from that blood on the corner of the Mizbeach, the altar, so the blood continue on Mizracha Tzafona, go from east to north on the corner of the altar. When it get close to Ma'aravit Dromit, the west, south of the altar, Noten Ma'arava, he sprinkled one time the blood to the west, ואחר כך, when he go around, noten daroma, he sprinkle the blood to the south of the altar. So in other words, when it's come to the first one, Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpah agreed with the Mishnah, Tanon Mishnah, that it's making one that there are actually two. But here, he disagreed. So we see here that we have a clear instruction from Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzpah, that he disagree with the other Mishnayot in the Tractate Tamid. So therefore, it has to be somebody else and not Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah who teach us this portion of the tractate Tamid. So the Gemara have a resolution. Ola Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Rabbi Yochanan come up with a resolution. Mantana Seder Yoma, Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah. So you have to say that one who give the Seder Tamid the way that it works in every day in the tractate Yoma, that's Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah. So the other Mishnayot, they go by the Chachamim, they disagree with him. But here, it's you have to say that our Mishnah contradicted the other Mishnah, it's followed by Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah. So even in that matter, he disagreed with the sages in the tractate Tamid. Even we heard only one thing from him, we derive from that, according to Rabbi Yochanan, all the others, he said. Verami, seder yoma, a seder yoma. So now we raise a contradiction from one Mishnah in tractate Yoma against another Mishnah in tractate Yoma, Ditnan. We will learn in Mitzvah Shem in page 25. Ditnan. Pais Hasheni, mi shochet, mi zorek, mi medashen mizbeach pnimi, umi medashen et amnora, umi male evarim la keves. So he said, when you have this second lottery that conducted daily among the Kohanim, determined who slaughtered the daily morning offering, who sprinkled the blood, who removed the ashes from the inner altar, who removes the ashes that burn wicks and the candle burn, who is limping daily offering up to the Rebbe. In other words, this is a big, big honor. And it, in order to avoid conflicts, we have a lottery. And whoever won does their part. So it's written here in order. So Rashi tells us again, today I'm using again my book several times. Rashi said, Mi shochet mi zorek. So Rashi said, Klomar ba'aseifa shlishit. So that he said that the third lottery was made in a new one, which means after the previous one understand who won, they come back and they do the third lottery, which means it wasn't in one time. They go and they do the lottery and then they in a way reconvene again for the third one. In short, you can read more in the book. I wish to have more time. Anyway, so they said here, and the following Mishnah in 26, they said, Pais HaShlishi Chadashim Laktoret Bo Ve'afisu. So they come to the third lottery. The one who appointed declares, let only those Kohanim who are new to offering the incense come and participate in the lottery for the incense. So removing the ashes from the lamp of the candle burn precede the burning of the incense, which contradicts the Mishnah here. Amar Abaye lo kashya. Abaye said it's not a conflict. Why? Kan be'atavat shnei nerot. Here we're speaking about the ashes, the removal of the ash of two lamps, which perform after the burning of the incense. Kan be'atavat chamesh nerot. And the other one speak about the removal of the ashes from five lamps, which precede the burning of the incense. So as will be explained, the Kohen attends the five lamps first, and after the break, he attends the final two lamps. Lemeimra de biktoret mafsik lehu. So may be said that the burning of the incense interposes between attending to the first five lamps and attending to the last two. So they said, Veha bayei mesader ma'aracha mishmei de gemara. That's what we said every day, right? That Abaye is the one who set up the order of the priestly functions in the way that we receive in our tradition. Bedam hatamid mafsiklu. He stopped when he sprinkled the daily blood between the five and the two. The five first and the two last. So that's the opposite to what we said earlier. Amre lo kashya, hi le'aba shaul le'rabanan. ones go by the opinion of Abba Shaul, so which means that the sequence cite in the Mishnah is according to the opinion of the Abba Shaul, and the other one is the Rabbi. So we learn in the Braita, the Tanya, Lo yetiv et hanerot. We learn in the Braita that one should not remove the ashes from the lamp. Ve achar kach yaktir, and then he should burn the incense. Ela yaktir v'achar kach yeitiv, but he should burn the incense, and then after he does the five candles burn, then he will do the two. Abba Shaul says that the opposite way. Meitiv v'achar kach mektir, one remove the ashes from the lamp and then burn the incense. So you see the different sources reflect the dispute we have in a Braita. Maita ma de Abba Shaul. What's the rationale, the opinion of Abba Shaul? Dichtiv, the Torah said in the book of Shmot, Exodus chapter 30, Baboker, Baboker, Betivo et Hanerot. So it's written twice, the word every morning, he removes the ashes from the lamb. And then the Torah said, Vehadar, and only then they said, Yaktirena, and he should burn it. So you see the process, which is very rational. You have to clean the lamp first, and then you have the incense burn. So it has to be in that process. So the making the incense, it's after that. The Rabbanan. So how the Rabbanan, how the sages respond to what Rabbi Shaul said? Maika marachman arav, the sages will say to you, what is the merciful one, which again it's applied to Hashem, the Torah, the Rachmana, it's called compassion. Be'id dan hatava tehem mektar ktoret, page 15. That at the time that you remove the ashes, you should burn the incense, and not later. So the Meiri said that the way that they did this incense, the process, it brings the smokes. Even the time that the Kohen was involved with all this process of preparation, which means that you lit the incense in a way that when you put the last process of candles, it's already have some smoke coming out of the incense. The ilotei mahache, that if you don't go that way, ben arbaim dechtiv, when the Torah used the term the burning of the afternoon incense. We said in the book of Shmot, chapter 30, and when Aharon lights the lamps in the afternoon, he should burn it. So how you learn it? You're going to tell me that the first lighting, the Kohen lighting the candles, and only then burn the afternoon incense? So the Gemara said, "V'chitei mahachei nami." And if you tell me, yes, it's so, ve'atanya, we learn. So we learn that the order is not like that. Why? Because it said me'erev ad boker, from the pasuk said in Exodus 27 to burn from evening until the morning. So we derive from that, tenla midata, you should bring you give the candle burn its measure of oil. So it's enough oil, shetehed oleket, good morning, shetehed oleket v'olechet, kol alayla me'erev ad boker. So the Kohen needs to put an order of the menorah in a way that the candles will be lit from the evening to the morning, which we explain several times the way we learn in Tractate Tamid, that is chatzilog, olive oil in each and every candle. Davar acher, me'erev ad boker, ein lecha avoda, shekshira me'erev ad boker, ela zo bilvad. So you derive from that the only service that is valid when performed from evening to morning. So lighting candle burn is the final daily Beit HaMikdash service, and the incense is not burned after the lamp are lit. So Rashi said here, "Ein lecha avodah shekshera." Klomar, "Ein lecha avodat yom tov kshera achrei hadlakatan." So I explained in my book, Klomar Berashi Lashas, I explained that if you go by what I'm thinking that Rashi meant, if you follow the way the Gemara said, you don't have an avoda that is proper from the evening to morning, you may misconstrue and think that that's apply the same avoda as the candle, that is from the evening to the morning. So Rashi said that we here have to have the mi'ut that apply to all the other type of avoda after lighting the candles. So that's one way. It's another way that Rashi here want to respond to what Tosfot Yom Tov ask. We said it's also in Tosfot Menachot 89 that the Mishnah at the beginning of Brachot said that Ekter Chalavim Vevarim, the time that you light all this part of the animals, it has to be Mibod Yom before the sun set. And basically Rashi wants to say that that's the walking of the day, Avodat Yom, cannot be after lighting the candles, but it's considering as a walk at night, and you have to do lechatchila in a proper time and not have it at later. Again, I wish to have more time, but you can read it in the book. It's a long explanation. Back to our subject. So we said, אין לך עבודה שקשרה מהר ועד בוקר לעזוב בלבד, אלא, מייקה, הרחמנה, what did Torah said, הנה פסוק, וואלו תעמרות המרות בין ארבעים מהקטירנה, בעידן הדלקה, תהן מקטר כתורת. But the time that lighting the candles, the already, as we said in the Meir, if you remember that, you see already the incense coming out of, the smoke coming out of the incense at that time. החנמה, here too, בעידן התווה תהן מקטר כתורת. When you prepare the candle light, the time that removal of the ashes, you should burn the incense. ואבא שאול אמר לך, and אבא שאול responded, and he said, שנעתם דכתיב אותו. He said that it's different, because the Torah said, it's that פסוק, Aaron and his sons will said it אותו, in here order. So that's the last one in the walking of the day. So we have to say that the pasuk, when it meant v'alot yaktirena, that lighting the incense take place when you have the last candle burn. But in regards to making it in the morning, we have to say it as it's written, which means that they go in the process first betivo and then yaktirena. First he prepared and then he put the incense. Which means, in short, that all the preparation of the neirot, of the candles, preceding to the process of the incense. Rav Papa amar lo kashya. Rav Papa said it's not the question. Harabanan Abba Shaul. He says it's not difficult because each Mishnah is according to opinion of different Tana. One Mishnah go by the rabbis, the other one go by the Abba Shaul. And now we said, "B'mayu kimtan matlit nachi." How would you learn this Mishnah properly? The Kirabanan, according to the sages, that said, "Pais Kaba Shaul," which means the Tana and the Mishnah follow according to the rabbis, and the sequence in the Mishnah, where the latter is discussed, is according to opinion of Abba Shaul, who disagree with the sages. So now the Gemara asks, "Im asefa aviu latetamid kratzo umerekach hashchita yado nichnas laktir daktorat v'lativ tanerot." Atan l'Rabbanan Rei Vashev Sefa, Rabbanan Umtziyat Abba Shaul. So he said, Amar Lach Papa, Ein Rei Shev Sefa, Rabbanan Umtziyat Abba Shaul. So even it's something that is very hard to understand, we have to say that you go this way, that the first and the last part of the Mishnah go by the sages, and the middle part go by the Abba Shaul. למה הבאי לא אמר כרב פאפה רישה וסייפה רבנן מציאת אבא שאות לא מוקים לה אלא רב פאפה מייטמה לא אמר אחי כהבאי. So we understand it's good רב פאפה is not willing to establish first clause the last clause according to opinion of the rabbis and the middle clause is according to opinion of אבא שאול. But according to רב פאפה What's the reason I did not say that follow the Abaye? So Amar lach tana bereisha atavat tenerot. The first part of the first clause of the Mishnah speaks about the two lamps, which is in a way performed later. And then, and only then, he told us that the removal of the ashes from the five lamps, which he performed before the ashes of the two lamps are clean. So therefore, we and the Sefer Papa prefer to establish the Mishnayot reflects to the Tanaic dispute rather than to accept the reversal of the order. Abaye said that Tana just mentioned in general statement. It doesn't go specific. He just wants to teach us that Kohen Gadol needs to occupy himself in the work all the 7 days. And by the way, he mentioned the exact order or the sequence order of the Mishnah that teaches us in the context of the actual performance of the service. First, Rambam, Ilchot Avodat, Yom HaKippurim, Chapter 1. Hargalat Kohen Gadol Ba'avodah. The sages accustom that the Kohen Gadol, the high priest, on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement service, during the 7 days of his sequestering, he sprinkled the blood, burned the incense, removed the ashes from the lamp of the candle burn, so that he would prepare to perform the service on Yom Kippur. So it has to be some type of, in our simple language, a rehearsal to prepare him, be ready. Kohen Gadol Makriv Chelek Barosh, the Rambam said in Chot Klei HaMikdash, chapter 5, that during the year, the Kohen Gadol does not participate in lottery like the rest of the Kohanim, but may perform any service that he chooses. He may also take any portion that he chooses before all the other Kohanim, since he has had the privilege of the Kohen Gadol. we also talk about the different type of pious, and we said that the 13 priests were chosen for the second lottery in the Beit HaMikdash. The one who's chosen in the lottery slaughters the daily morning offering, and the Kohanim next to him removed the blood and so on. So that was the sequence in the Mishnah, and it's based on the Rambam, the Sefer Avodah, Ilchot, Tmidim, and Musafim, chapter 4.